A very good evening to all. I, Sukriti, welcomes you on behalf of Live Law in the second lecture of Live Law's practitioner series, which is today on the topic meaning of proved in Indian Evidence Act. Today we have Mr. B.G. Harendranath, former district judge and former additional director of Kerala Judicial Academy, will be sharing his insights upon the topic. Now let me directly introduce our guest speaker. So sir enrolled in the year 1984 and practiced in the Kerala High Court in the chambers of Sri K.P. Dandapani, the former Advocate General of Kerala. He appointed in the Kerala Judicial Service in the year 1991 and promoted as District Judge in 2004. Later, he was appointed as a professor in National Judicial Academy, Bhopal in the year 2009. He was a district judge in Manjeri. He was also an additional director of Kerala Judicial Academy in 2012 and also served as law secretary in the government of Kerala in 2015. Sir got retired in 2019 and now practicing as a lawyer in the High Court of Kerala. Now before wasting your time and over to you, sir, is just a humble request to our attendees to kindly post their questions in the Q&A box where we would be picking up your questions in the end when sir will finish. So over to you, sir.
Very good evening, Sukriti. Very good evening to all the attendees. In fact, the definition of proved in the Evidence Act is something of cardinal importance so far as judicial trial is concerned. It is in the year 1870 that Stephen came to the shores of India, James Fitzjames Stephen, who came and became a member of the Law Commission of India, appointed by the British government after the Indian Councils Act in 1861. So far as legislation in the British India is concerned, this was the latter part of the 19th century was the most fruitful period. You would find that the Contract Act, the Trust, Indian Trust Act, Transfer of Property Act, the Easements Act, several enactments relating to substantive law was enacted during the period when Stephen was a member of the Law Commission. The Evidence Act, the Criminal Procedure Code of 1898, the Civil Procedure Code, in all these enactments, Stephen had a pivotal role. If you make a forensic analysis, you would find Stephen's handwriting all over the enactments during that period. So one of the most important enactments so far as judicial trial is concerned is the Indian Evidence Act. It is pivotal. It is actually the fulcrum around which the entire judicial trial revolves around. Generation of belief in the mind of the trier of the fact and the rules relating to that you find in the Law of Evidence or Indian Evidence Act of 1872. There is a philosophy underlying the Indian Evidence Act. In fact, the premises on which the rules of evidence were formulated and the procedures in which they are embedded are in large part product of the belief which rule makers had about human psychology, the way people receive, retrieve, and disseminate information, how people make judgments, how people draw inferences, and the rules were grounded on this philosophy relating to generation of belief. And the epistemology of Law of Evidence, part of it is to be found in Mill's theory of reasoning, ratiocination, which you will find in the celebrated book of John Stuart Mill. Stephen, in fact, was a pupil of John Stuart Mill. Now, a fact finder, in fact, this evidence law was formulated primarily with the jury trial in mind. In those days, in India also, like you find in the other common law countries, the fact used to be adjudicated by the jury. And judges only directed the jury on the questions of law, decided admissibility and relevancy regarding the evidence written in court. It is after the celebrated Nanavati's case that jury trial completely ended in India. Now we don't have jury trial. We only have judges trying cases. So there are exclusionary rules so far as evidence law is concerned. And there is a lot of debate why these exclusionary rules are there. One reason is some commentators say that it is because jury were trying the cases and they are likely to be easily dissuaded by the inadmissible or irrelevant evidence and come to the wrong conclusions based on such evidence. And therefore, they used to say that this was the reason why the Indian Evidence Act or the entire evidence law in the common law country centered around exclusionary rules. But John Langby and several other thinkers say that it is not so. Why? Because in continental countries where the trial is, where there is no adversarial system, the judge lets in evidence. The judge is the one who proffers evidence. And there are no two adversaries so far as the trial is concerned. So far as the adversarial system is concerned, the evidence is proffered by one side. The opposite side again produces. If it is a criminal trial, prosecution produces the evidence. And then defense also produces the evidence. And the trier of the fact, whether it be a judge or the jury, ultimately has to sit and analyze these facts and come to a finding. So because the parties have such a sway in producing evidence, there will be whole lot of evidence which are irrelevant, which will lead the judicial trial completely astray. And that is the primary reason which, according to some thinkers, predominant thinkers, the reason for having these exclusionary rules in the evidence law. All over the common law countries, you find this exclusionary rules. Now, see, so far as the psychology of law, law of evidence is concerned, there is an interesting book, Psychology and the Psychological Foundations of the Law of Evidence by Michael J. Sachs and Barbara Spellman. They say that our legal ancestors seem to have been more acutely aware of the contested assumptions underlying the evidence doctrine than their modern descendants. So evidence law, which was formulated way back in England and taken over in all common law countries, is based on the psychological foundations of human thinking, human behavior, human recollection, retrieving, then dissemination of information and the analysis of whatever comes before their mind and how they judge facts, which contested facts which appear before them, whether it be jury or the judge. So these are, the evidence law is founded on these crucial foundations of human psychology and other reasoning processes and philosophy. The epistemology of evidence, if you want to find, you can read the Langbein's excellent article in Cornell Law Review, which you can find. You can download and read that. Now, coming back to our Evidence Act, as I want to tell you, my experience as a lawyer in the High Court, as a trial judge, as a district judge spanning over 37 years, I must tell you that all matters, as judges, we decide a case in a holistic manner, not bits and pieces. Ultimately, we see the entire case and then we apply the technical legal rules to come to a conclusion. It is always viewed in a holistic manner. This is the underlying principle in the Evidence Act as well, so far as generation of belief is concerned. One of the most important sections in the Evidence Act is the definition of proof. The definition of proof contains two parts. I will just read out the definition of proof from the Evidence Act so that you will see. A fact is said to be proved when, after considering the matters before it, the court either believes it to exist or considers its existence so probable that a prudent man ought, under the circumstances of the particular case, act on the supposition that it exists. Now, there are two parts of it. I'll come to that. See, a fact is said to be proved when after considering the matters before it. Why did the legislature use the word considering the matters before it? Why not evidence? Why not fact? Because precise meanings are given to each word in the Evidence Act. When you come to the matters, it takes in everything. See, evidence means it includes under the Evidence Act, deposition of witness in court, then the documents produced before the court. Now, if a material object is produced, it comes under the second proviso to section 16. For the profference, it is proffered when the judge, if some witness speaks about a material object, and if the judge wants to see that, under the second part of section 60 of the Evidence Act, it is produced before the court. So this broadly are the matters, and therefore, that is why one of the reasons why the word evidence is not used, because it is a constricted meaning so far as the evidence is concerned. Now, why not fact? See, fact also is particularly defined in the Evidence Act. Fact means and includes anything, state of things or relation of things, capable of being perceived by the senses, then any mental condition of which any person is conscious. Now, the senses are sight, hearing, smell, touch, taste, anything, state of thing, relation of things. Relation of things is I am sitting here, I've got a laptop in front of me that belongs to me, or the chairs are arranged in a particular manner. Let us say that is state of things, or a car is in motion. It is a state of thing. So that is why it takes in presumptions. It takes the matters taken evidence, matters taken facts, matters taken presumptions, matters taken several other matters. That is why, so far as to give it more precision, the word considering the matters before it is used. Then regarding the belief, after considering the matters before it, court believes the facts to exist, either believes it to exist or considers its existence so probable that a prudent man ought under the circumstances of the particular case act upon the supposition that it exists. So the first part is the court either believes it to exist. The second part is the court considers its existence so probable in the standard of a prudent man who under the circumstances of the particular case should act on the supposition that it exists. So is there any difference between these two aspects regarding court either believes it to exist or the second part considers its existence so probable that a prudent man ought under the circumstances of a particular case act on the supposition that the fact exists? In other words, the trier of the fact, the fact finder, sitting in the chair of a judge, acts as a prudent man. Now, there is a disputed fact and evidence is proffered on that by either of the parties. So he has to find whether he believes the fact to exist or he believes that the fact is so probable and act on this and that so probable that a prudent man would act on the supposition that the fact exists. Now, the first case on this aspect was Vijayi Singh's case. Vijayi Singh was the state of Uttar Pradesh, which was rendered in 1990 by Chief Justice Ratnavel Pandian. It is a three judgment decision of the Supreme Court. So it makes an interesting reading. The learned judges say that the section is worded to provide for two conditions of mind. That is, believes it to exist. And the learned judges say that first, that in a man which feels absolutely certain of a fact, then he would believe it to exist. Then the second part, he thinks so extremely probable that a prudent man would act under the circumstances, assume that it does exist. Now, can we say that this gives a clear picture of the of a judicial trial, or the real meaning of the word proved appearing in the Evidence Act? Now, absolutely certain, that is the word used by the learned judges. See, absolutely, absolute certainty is something which does not happen in human affairs. In this imperfect world, nothing is perfect. So when evidence is adduced before a court, court can never say that it really exists and it is an absolute certainty, because court is adjudging on matters which are not perceived by it, perceived by a witness, and a witness comes and tells before the court that this is what he perceived. So far as the witness perception is concerned, there are two probabilities, two improbabilities as well. One is his faculties of perception may not be very good.
Yes.
That he may be not a credible witness. So how do you evaluate the testimony of a witness? Testimony of a witness is evaluated on two premises. One, if his faculties of perception, hearing, sound, smell, everything is very good, all the five senses are good, and he's speaking of one element. If it is good, you can assume that he must be telling something which is perceived correctly. But if he has some other motive, suppose he is not a credible witness, then obviously you can't believe his testimony. So how do you come to such a conclusion? You cannot with certainty say that a certain witness is always telling the truth, or that what he perceived was exactly like this, exactly as how he describes. Now, the other day, about the human mind, there is an interesting book by Munsterberg on witness stand. And there was someone was speaking about how mind tricks you. A person was standing on the stage. He said that I have a basket. In that basket, there is apple, there is all kinds of fruits. He names all the fruits. There is mango, there is apple, there is pomegranate, there are other things. Then later on, he asked the persons who had seen this, what all are the matters which I have told, just told you all, which I have. Then did I say apple? Most of them said, yes, you said apple. Did I say pomegranate? Yes, you said it's a pomegranate. Did I say another fruit? They said, yes, you said that fruit. Did I say fruit basket? Most of the people who listened to this narration said that, yes, you said fruit basket. But then it is a trick. He never said fruit basket. He only said basket. But then the mind is tricking you. You think that what he said was a fruit basket because it is a basket containing a lot of fruits. This is how mind tricks you. And then a witness who has perceived these matters in this fashion comes and deposes before the court. It can't be with absolute certainty. No court can say that a fact is, that he can be absolutely certain of the fact about which witness says. So believes it to exist cannot, in my humble opinion, be something which the court is absolutely certain about. Later decisions, especially in Rasigram's case, there is an earlier decision, which is in 1975. Supreme Court said that this definition does not insist on perfect proof, because absolute certainty amounting to demonstration is rarely to be had in affairs of life. Nonetheless, the standard of measuring of proof prescribed by the definition is that of a person of prudence and practical good sense. This is what the Supreme Justice Krishnayar in Rasigram's case said in 1975. So absolute certainty is something which is not there in human affairs. And when you are reconstructing a past event, you can never say that this a particular thing is absolutely certain. Believes it to exist and considers a matter highly probable, or highly probable that it had existed in the past, are more or less a similar, more or less a similar thing. Now, a conviction of truth of a proposition that exists subjectively in the mind of the person. And then there is a narration of that, and then the narration, from the narration of that in court, the court infers that what is said about that proposition or the event by the witness is true. That is after weighing the probabilities by what I have just told. Belief is an assurance gained by evidence. And it is suspicion. Sometimes, you know, even suspicion, though it is weaker than belief, suspicion also sometimes is similar to a belief, but suspicion is not belief. Suspicion is weaker than belief, since suspicion requires no real foundation of its existence, while belief is based on assumed facts. Now, there is a difference between, now, can a person believe something which is not probable? No, he cannot believe something which is not probable. According to Ramanatha Iyer's dictionary, belief admits of all degrees suspicion to the fullest assurance, a state of mind that regards existence of something as likely or relatively certain. Now, Vijay Singh's case, you find there is a juxtaposition of belief with absolute certainty, in contradistinction with the probability part of it, that consider that trier of the fact thinks that the fact is so probable that the prudent man ought to act on the supposition that it exists. So this actually, is it in contradistinction or not? American Supreme Court, when discussing about the generation of belief in the mind of the trier of the fact, in Re Winship, they have said, the fact finder, they say, that cannot acquire unassailably accurate knowledge of what happened. All that the fact finder can acquire is a belief of what probably happened. The intensity of that belief, the degree to which a fact finder is convinced of that given fact, of course, varies from case to case. Unassailably accurate knowledge or absolute certainty does not exist. In Garib Singh's case also, the Supreme Court said that the Indian Evidence Act only employs the standards of a prudent man in judging what is deemed to be proved according to law. So therefore, the entire matter relating to this definition of proved, if you go to the definition, the believing it to exist is also based on a probability, high probability. Preponderance of probability and the probability arising, second part of the definition says that the fact finder considers it to be so probable. It is a prudence man standard. And these are both one and the same or very similar. Then why was it used, either believes it to exist or considers its existence so probable? Well, one can only say that the all laws may contain a surplusage so far as the drafting is concerned. So therefore, you cannot say that two different standards are employed in the definition itself. Most of the decisions say that what you believe is what is probable, and the intensity of this belief, the degree to which one person is convinced or a judge is convinced that a given fact actually occurred, can vary according to the circumstances of each case. Now, the only decision on this point which explains this contradistinction. This is the ruling that these are used in contradistinction. That is, believes it to exist and considers its existence so probable. This is the only decision we have is Vijay Singh's case. Most of the other cases do not deal with the contradistinction which Vijay Singh has pointed out. And most of the decisions also are to the effect that the inference of these facts, in the inference of these facts, the generation of belief in the mind of the trier of the fact, the human probability or the standard of the prudent man is the same so far as the first part is concerned and the second part is concerned. So therefore, so now we come to the aspect of standard of proof so far as evidence law is concerned. Standard of proof is a degree of proof that is required to prove a particular fact. Now, civil cases, the standard of proof is said to be the preponderance of probabilities. Whereas in criminal cases, the standard is standard of beyond a reasonable doubt. It is not beyond shadow of doubt or beyond all doubts or something like that. It is beyond a reasonable doubt. A reasonable doubt. Now, so far as Evidence Act is concerned, there are several Supreme Court decisions. There is no difference between general rules of evidence in civil and criminal cases. And the definition of proof in Section 3 of the Evidence Act does not draw a distinction between civil and criminal cases. Now, how do we analyze so far as a civil case is concerned? Now, what is required to be proved in a case, whether it is civil or criminal, is a fact in issue. Fact in issue is the fact in issue has been defined in the Evidence Act. It means and includes any fact from which either by itself or in connection with other facts, the existence, non-existence, the extent of any right or liability asserted in a suit or proceeding necessarily follows. That is the meaning of the word fact in issue. As I said before, the fact is separately defined. Relevant fact is not defined. Relevant fact is defined in the same section as one fact is relevant to another when one is connected with the other in any other ways referred to in the provisions of this act relating to the relevancy of the fact. That is the definition given in the Evidence Act. But so far as relevant fact is concerned, Stephen's book on evidence law contains a definition. Now we are coming to the fact in issue. Fact in issue is the most important thing. So fact in issue means a fact from which either by itself or in connection with other facts, the existence, non-existence, nature or extent of any right, liability, disability asserted or denied in any suit or proceeding necessarily follows. So once the fact in issue is proved, what happens is that, what is a fact in issue in a murder case? It is whether the mens rea and the actus reus, whether a person, whether the accused has committed a particular crime, whether he did the act, whether he had the intention to, that whether he had the necessary mens rea to commit the crime. These are the facts in issue. In a civil case, for instance, if it is a promissory note suit, a simple suit, the question would be whether a promissory note has been executed, whether consideration has passed, and whether the presumptions do exist. These are, now the question whether the, when the promissory note is executed, the fact is proved, then the presumption follows that it is supported by consideration. Then the party filing the suit is entitled to the relief in that particular case. So far as a criminal trial is concerned, the sentence, the conviction and sentence would necessarily follow. So that is why the fact and issue, which is pivotal to the adjudication of the case, is the matter which has to be proved. So those facts which are relevant to the proving the fact and issue, which posits the inference that fact and issue exist or not, those are relevant facts. So far as the Evidence Act is concerned, we all know that only the fact and issue and relevant facts can be admitted in evidence, together with not only that, the fact and issue and relevant fact, even if it is the relevant fact, should also be admissible according to the provisions in the Evidence Act. So far as a criminal trial is concerned, the standard of proof is that of preponderance of standard of proof is that of beyond, standard of proof should be that beyond a reasonable doubt, whereas in the case of civil cases it should be beyond preponderance of probabilities. Now, what is the meaning of the term preponderance of probabilities? Now, plaintiff adduces evidence. Now, when the plaintiff adduces evidence and it is looks probable, if it is improbable, there is no question of looking into the defendant's evidence. If the execution of promissory note is disproved, then the defense need not be looked into. So when the plaintiff's evidence looks probable, then necessarily defendant's evidence has to be looked into. If that also looks probable, the question is which is more probable. So there is one which, suppose the plaintiff's evidence preponderates over the defendant's evidence, necessarily the fact and issue has to be found in favor of the person in whose favor the evidence, the preponderance exists. And therefore, preponderance of probability is applicable, as I told you, in civil cases. In so far as criminal cases are concerned, the Evidence Act does not make a distinction, but the judge-made laws throughout the common law countries, and also the standard is that of beyond a reasonable doubt. Not all doubts, not all fetishes which comes in your mind, but the doubt should be a reasonable doubt. And if there is a reasonable doubt, it is not possible to convict a person because the benefit is given to the accused. So far as that is, because there is a person's liberty is considered to be very sacrosanct so far as judicial trials are concerned. So one cannot trample upon the liberty of a person unless fully convinced that he is guilty. That is why this standard has been imposed by judges throughout the ages, that for a person to be convicted, the guilt has to be proved beyond reasonable doubt. Now, going back to the definition of proof, we have, in a criminal case, we may have direct evidence on the fact and issue. Now, suppose a stabbing incident has occurred and a witness comes and deposes before court that he has seen the incident of stabbing and the weapon is recovered. Then necessarily it is an evidence on fact and issue. There is not much difficulty. The only question is whether the witness is credible and whether his faculties of perception are correct, whether he was able to, or ordinarily he could have seen the incident. Now, suppose it is in the teeth of a night and the witness was standing around 50 meters away and somebody comes and says that I have correctly identified the accused. Well, there is a serious doubt, a reasonable doubt. Could he have seen this person who was standing 50 meters away in the darkness? But not possible. So therefore, this doubt gives the benefit of doubt, is given to the accused, and ordinarily he is acquitted. But in the so far as circumstantial evidence is concerned, there is a it is a little more difficult situation. There is a popular adage which says that witnesses may lie, but circumstances will not lie. Well, that is always not correct, because circumstantial evidence is considered to be weaker than direct evidence. Why? Because in the direct evidence, there is only a fallacy of perception and inference. Fallacy of perception. So far as circumstantial evidence is concerned, there is a fallacy of perception and then there is a fallacy of inference from the circumstances. So therefore, one cannot say that circumstantial evidence is always superior to direct evidence. Obviously, it depends on the facts of each case. Now, in the matter of circumstantial evidence, the definition of proof, we find two kinds of facts. One is the primary fact, and the other is the guilt of the accused. The entire facts, the fact in issue, relating to the guilt of the accused. Now, what is the standard to be applied in dealing with primary facts and the entire case? That is why at the beginning I said that judges view a case in a holistic manner. They actually evaluate in a holistic manner, reaching tentative conclusions by applying the legal principles on the entire evidence. So you don't do trial by bits and pieces and come to a conclusion. But then the bits and pieces evidence is before you. If it is admissible and relevant, it is admitted. And then ultimately you look at the entire case. That is the manner in which, in fact, this is what Richard Posner in his book Divergent Paths says, that judges always look at a matter in a holistic manner. Now, coming to circumstantial evidence, what is circumstantial evidence? If you look at the etymology of circumstantial evidence, circum means what surrounds. Circumstance means something which stands. So circumstantial evidence is not the evidence on the fact in issue, but it is the evidence of circumstances which are surrounding the commission of the offense. Now, so if you have to find that a person is guilty, the circumstances should posit an inference, the only inference, that the person is guilty. If the circumstances do not posit, if there is a, if the chain is not complete, the chain of circumstances should be complete and it should bind the accused and there should be no room for escape. And the circumstances, it is the judicial decision say, should be fully established. Then the question arises whether the person is guilty or not. At this stage, now the question of burden of proof arises. So far as primary facts are concerned, the decisions generally, even in American decisions and also the constitution bench decision in constitution bench decision also says that the question of burden, question of application of the standard of proof, that is beyond a reasonable doubt, arises only with regard to the guilt of the accused and not to the primary facts. Now the question is, what are primary facts? If you look at the decision in Lord Denning in British Launderers Research Association, 1949, 1 King's Bench 462, that is reported in All England Law Reports, 1949 All England Law Reports, page 21. Lord Denning draws a distinction between primary facts and the conclusions which arise from primary facts. According to Lord Denning, primary facts are facts which are observed by witnesses and proved by oral testimony, or facts proved by the production of the thing itself, such as original documents. So in adjudging whether these facts which are observed by witnesses or facts proved by the production of a thing itself, like the original document. The determination is essentially a question of fact for the tribunal of fact. And the only question of law that can arise is whether there was any evidence to support the finding. At that particular stage, the question of preponderance of probabilities or the question of beyond a reasonable doubt does not arise. Insofar as criminal cases is concerned, it is the question of beyond a reasonable doubt. Now, the constitution bench decision in M.G. Agarwal versus State of Maharashtra, which is reported in 63 Supreme Court 200, it was a case in which three officials of the Income Tax Department were charged with offenses punishable under Section 120D, 467, 471 of the IPC, and Section 5, Subsection 2 of the PC Act, not this PC Act, old PC Act. The trial judge, in fact, acquitted the two accused, and convicted the third accused alone. So they went up in appeal. High Court reversed the conviction of the second accused. And then when ultimately the matter reached the Supreme Court, the question which involved the facts which were in that case related to return of income tax, refund. In fact, fictitious accounts were opened and money was refunded. The money went to these fictitious accounts. Then false bills were created to support, false vouchers were created to support these payments. That is payments to, and this, there was malversation of accounts as well. Now, so far as the evidence relating to this, the vouchers, the fictitious accounts were concerned, these were all primary facts. And the Supreme Court, the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court said, while in paragraph 18 said that in applying the principle of beyond a reasonable doubt, it is necessary to distinguish between the facts which are called primary or basic on the one hand, and inference of facts to be drawn from them. In regard to proof of basic or primary facts, the Honorable Supreme Court held that the court has to judge the evidence in the ordinary way. And in the appreciation of evidence in respect of basic or primary facts, their lordship said that there is no scope for application of the doctrine of benefit of doubt. So the doctrine of benefit of doubt or a beyond a reasonable doubt is not to be applied as per the decision of the Supreme Court in the matter of appreciation of evidence in respect of basic or primary facts. As I told you, in that case, it was the creation of false entries, the fictitious accounts, payment of money into these fictitious accounts. These are all primary facts where the question of burden of proof, the question of proof beyond a reasonable doubt never arised. Whether when a bill is produced before court, there is no room for application of the doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt. So therefore, according to the Constitution Bench, it only applies ultimate fact, that is the fact in issue, which is the guilt to the accused. So this decision of the M.G. Agarwal's case was followed by several benches of the Supreme Court. And there is an important decision, there are two or three important decisions, of American decisions. One is in Kilcoyne's case, State versus Kilcoyne. That is the decision of New Hampshire Circuit Court. In fact, Circuit Court is something similar to our High Court in India, so far as United States is concerned. It is reported in 135A 532, bracket New Hampshire, 1926. Then there are several other decisions, and Wigmore on evidence, that is Peter Tiller's evidence, Wigmore on evidence, Walters Floyd edition, we contain this passage, which says that there is no question of application of the doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt in the matter of primary facts. In fact, in Kilcoyne's case, which I had just stated, all the elements of the crime, most of the elements of the crime were conceded. In that case, it was held that the rule beyond a reasonable doubt does not apply to evidentiary fact. It only applies according to the judges of the New Hampshire court to the whole issue, not to detailed facts. So therefore, even when Gajendra Gadkar used the terms beyond a primary fact, and that the doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt does not apply to primary facts, he was very well aware of the certain nuances of evidence law. In fact, you find an excellent exposition of evidence law in Gajendra Gadkar's 69th report of the Law Commission. Now, so far as Sona Shinde's case was Sonba Shinde was a state of Maharashtra, Kishore Chand was a state of Himachal Pradesh, Parashunath versus state of Karnataka. These are all several decisions. If you nowadays we have search engines, and you can easily find out these decisions, which have relied on M.G. Agarwal's case and categorically held that in the matter of primary facts or basic facts, the question of the rule relating to beyond a reasonable doubt does not apply. It only applies in the matter of ultimate fact or the fact in issue. Now, so after M.G. Agarwal's case, we find another important case is the Rana Pratap versus state of Haryana. In that, the trial court acquitted all three accused. High court convicted all of them under section 302 of the IPC. And then their lordships held that the principle of beyond a reasonable doubt only applies to the guilt of the accused. Now coming to the question of fact in issue as defined by Stephen. See, fact in issue is that fact which gives rise to, if proved, will give a party a relief in a particular case or mulct a person with liability if the fact in issue is proved. Now, when coming to the civil cases, you would find, that is why I said, even if you go to the civil procedure code or the criminal procedure code, all these things are interconnected. And since James Fitzjames Stephen had primary role in drafting all these legislations, the interconnection is very visible. Now, if you look at the explanation to the word fact in issue in the Evidence Act, the explanation says, whenever under the provisions of the law for the timing in force relating to civil procedure, any court records an issue of fact, that fact to be asserted or denied in the answer to issue is a fact in issue. Now you look at Order 14 of the CPC. Order 14 of the CPC says that issues arise when material propositions of fact and law averred by one party is denied by the other party. Material propositions of fact and law averred by the one party is denied by the other party. Now what are material propositions? Material propositions under the Order 14 Rule 2 are those propositions which gives rise to a right to relief so far as a party is concerned. So this is the interconnection. Now you look at criminal procedure code, charge is something which is framed by court. Now charge contains the fact in issue. It is a charge which has to be proved by the charge framed by the court, which has to be proved by the prosecution, nothing else. So these interconnections are there in so far as evidence law is concerned. You will find that in the criminal procedure code as well as the civil procedure code. So the what is pivotal to judicial trial is generation of belief in the mind of the trier of a fact, the person who tries the facts and who adjudicates. And it is of pivotal importance that the definition of proof appearing in the Evidence Act is correctly understood. And though it has some ambiguity, nonetheless, it is founded on the premise that a prudent man, it is a standard of a prudent man. And then once a prudent man under ordinary circumstances considers the existence of that particular fact which is proffered before the court is probable, then the inference by the court should be that it is probable, and the court ought to act under the supposition that it exists. Now what about the previous part, believes it to exist? A court would believe a fact to exist only if it is probable in accordance with the standard of the prudent man. Now so far as criminal trials is concerned, let me say regarding a circumstantial evidence part, case based on a circumstantial evidence, let us say there is a flag burning case, hypothetical case. Now somebody sees a flag burning, so that is an offense. So if somebody has set fire to the flag, it is an offense. Now another person sees a person carrying the flag in his hand and going towards a flagpole. The third person, say for a doctor, says that the person who was carrying the flag, he had burns in his hand. So these are the three pieces of evidence before the court. Now the question is whether you can find the person guilty or not. Maybe he had gone to hoist the flag. Maybe that his hand got burnt while he was trying to douse the fire. These are all reasonable doubts which would appear in the mind of the trier of the fact. So there are reasonable doubts, and then you cannot find that the person is guilty with this circumstantial evidence, because no one has seen the fact in issue. No one has deposed regarding the fact in issue. That is, as to who has set fire to the flag or not. So this is one example which I have to narrate before you. Insofar as circumstantial evidence is concerned, so there is no question of applying the doctrine of guilt regarding the doctor's doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt. When the doctor sees the hand, burnt hand, where is the application of the doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt applied? There is no question of application of that doctrine. Somebody says that he saw the flag burning, where is the question of the doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt coming into the picture? All these three facts, though they are connected with each other, these are all primary facts, and ultimately it is the chain of circumstances which should posit an inference, and that inference should be regarding the guilt of the accused and nothing else. Now does it posit an inference regarding the guilt of the accused? There are reasonable doubts in these matters. He could have, maybe that he was trying to douse the fire. He must have hoisted the flag. He must have doused the fire. Maybe that he has set the flag on fire. Anything can happen. But then the conviction or guilt of the accused does not stand fully established. Insofar as this case, I mean, circumstances are not fully established, and the guilt of the accused is not proved beyond a reasonable doubt. So this principle of beyond a reasonable doubt, as I told you, is judgment law. But this will not apply in a civil case is because plaintiff adduces evidence, and if the plaintiff's evidence is probable, the next question is whether the defendant's evidence is probable, which preponderates over the other. So this is the real tenor of Section 3 is this. But in addition, there is a judgment law so far as criminal cases are concerned. Now I have read out Vijay Singh's case. If you read Vijay Singh's case, if you fully read Vijay Singh's case, you will find that this contradistinction is not there in the judgment as such. Because though they have used the words absolute certainty, absolutely certain, several decisions say, and including the old decisions say, that absolute certainty is something which you cannot have in so far as judicial trials are concerned. Judicial trials are very similar to historic inquiries. Both try to reconstruct what happened in the past. But historic inquiries, you know, you can look into any matter because there is no need for a historic inquiries to end within a particular time frame. But so far as judicial trials are concerned, it cannot be open-ended. We have to render a decision, whether you know or not, you have to render a decision within a particular time frame. Our justice administration machinery has got international disrepute because the time lag. In fact, when I was presiding over a court at Quilon, which is in the southern part of Kerala, there was a case which was pending from 1923 onwards, which was before me. But I could not fully dispose it of. So I tried to dispose it of a lot of applications. It related to an insolvency matter. After insolvency, where insolvency was annulled, the property in the possession of the receiver had to be handed over to quantum insolvency. Now, there are obvious reasons for this. One is the judge population ratio. We don't have enough number of courts in our country so that we can dispose of these cases. Secondly, there is no alternate dispute redressal mechanism. Though we have a few, they have propped up in the recent years. It should be more effective. I'm not saying that it's not effective. It is very effective. It should be more effective. And ultimately, what should come to the court? It should be before litigation. Now, what happens is it comes to litigation and then goes there. I am digressing on this central matter. Now, coming back to the law of evidence, I've said that the premises on which the rules are made are actually based on the beliefs of human psychology, the way in which people receive, store, retrieve information, disseminate information, infer matters. The entire Evidence Act is based on this philosophy, and synthesis you find in the definition of crude. That is what is very important so far as definition of crude is concerned. Now, I have been now we have come across two aspects of the definition of crude. One is relating to criminal trial, the circumstantial evidence, and the other is regarding primary facts. And now, the Justice K.T. Thomas in Narasingh Rao's case, he was speaking for the three-judge bench decision. His lordship held that the word proof need not be understood in the sense in which it is defined in the Evidence Act, because proof depends on the admissibility of the evidence. This is the definition given for the word proof in the Evidence Act. What is required, according to the Supreme Court, is production of such materials on which the court can reasonably act to reach the supposition that a fact exists. Of course, proof of fact depends on the degree of probability of it having existed. The standard, according to the Supreme Court, required for reaching the supposition is that of the prudent man acting in any important matter concerning him. Now, in an important decision, the House of Lords has said, proof does not mean proof to rigid mathematical demonstration, because that is impossible. It must mean such evidence as would induce a reasonable man to come to a particular conclusion. That is what is meant by, see, that is the standard we find in the definition of proof. The reasonable man and the prudent man are one and the same. The observation in which I have read out in Hawkins versus Powell Tillery Steam Coal Company, that is where it has been said that proof does not mean proof to rigid mathematical demonstration, because that is impossible. That comes from the decision. The said observation, you see, has been followed throughout, even by our courts. In fact, Narsingh Rao's case, the Supreme Court, which I have said just before, that is reported in AR 2001 Supreme Court 318. There also, the observation in Fletcher Moulton's case, they say, has stood this test of time and can be followed as a standard of proof. What the court does is that court uses the process of inference drawn from the facts produced or proved. The inferences are which the court draws are akin to presumptions in law. In fact, law actually gives discretion to the court to presume the existence of any fact which it thinks it likely to have happened. Well, it should be probable. It should not be simply likely to have happened. It should be so probable that a prudent man would act on the supposition that it had happened. In that course, court has regard to common course of natural events, human conduct, and facts of the particular case. Now, proof of a fact, as I said, depends on the degree of probability of it having existed. The standard required is that of a prudent man. Now, ultimately, Krishna Gopal's case, the Supreme Court says that ultimately the decision in a case rests on robust common sense and trained intuition of a judge. The judge presiding over the court, his trained intuition and robust common sense is what ultimately determines the outcome of a case. Now, what is a trained intuition of a judge? See, when Supreme Court says, refers to the word trained intuition. Now, suppose you are driving a car. If it is a car with a gear, you would change the gear, you would apply brake, you would apply clutch. These are all not by reasoning process that you do it in your mind. You know, you should change the gear. It automatically comes to you. It is a trained intuition. Likewise, over the years, the training by degrees, as Stephen has said, gives judges an intuition, a trained intuition into deciding the case. So, Krishna Gopal's case, the Supreme Court has said, robust common sense and trained intuition are the guidepost so far as judges are concerned. See, Richard Posner, one of the celebrated judges in America, said that judging is a job in which experience does generate knowledge and can sharpen intuition. And in these ways, can go to quite a distance towards replacing analytical effort and acuity. That is a remark of a great judge who has written several books on judging. He has written a book, How Judges Think, which is a book on how judges evaluate matters appearing before them and then come to conclusions. Then, see, dependability of any kind of evidence under consideration, you know, might involve concerns about nature of human perception and memory. See, ultimately, it is the ability of the fact finders to comprehend the evidence, assess its soundness, consider its implication on the factual issues which they have to resolve, and then come to a finding. That is what is required of the fact finder. And for this, the definition of proof is obviously, even though it is a short definition, is a real guidepost. So far as we lawyers are concerned, there is something called metacognition. Metacognition is something, is the ability to think about one's own and also to others' reasoning processes. Now you have to think about the reasoning process which the opposite party would put, also the reasoning process which judge will ultimately adopt. So this metacognition part is may be required for a judge. I'm sorry, the lawyer. But so far as the judge is concerned, there is no question of metacognition. Judge has to ultimately look into the evidence which is proffered before him, weigh the evidence, and in terms of the evidence act, consider that whether the existence of the fact urged by one of the parties is so probable in the standard of a prudent man, and act on the supposition that it exists or does not exist. Now, actually, what the court does is court considers the version of a fact, whether it is probable, improbable, or artificially, or artificial, based on the testimony, based on the documents, based on other matters which are before court. Now, regarding the use of the words disjunctive participle in the definition of proof, that is either or, either believes it to exist or considers its existence so probable. Now Justice G.P. Singh, in his interpretation of statutes, says that at times the intention of legislature is clear, but the unskillfulness of the draft in introducing certain words in the statute result in apparent ineffectiveness of language. Courts lean against reducing a statute to futility. It is permissible in such cases to reject the surplus words to make the statute effective and workable. But then there is no question of ignoring the surplus words. Nonetheless, if you holistically look at the definition of the term, there is not much of a difference in believing whether the words believe it to exist or consider the probability part of it in the standard of a prudent man. There is not much of a difficulty in reconciling these difficulties. In fact, there are in one decision, 9 words in Privy Council had said that it was surplusage. G.P. Singh, in his book on celebrated book on interpretation of statutes, referred to House of Lords decision in 1990. There also 4 words were read as surplusage, and they were issued from the. It was not taken into consideration for construing the statute. Now, could we say, we are saying, could we say whether the words either in the definition proved is surplusage or not? There are various meanings to the word belief, beliefs, persuasion, conviction, absolute certainty, suspicion, preponderance of probability, and all these matters. It is one thing to say that you cannot believe something which is not probable. Even if when a witness speaks about a fact and issue, what you evaluate is whether his faculties of perception, or if you are evaluating that, and whether it is probable that he could have seen that or he could have heard that. That is the matter which you evaluate. And therefore, the intensity of belief depends on the proffered evidence. The definition of proof, therefore, containing two parts, cannot be held to be alternative. That is what I think, in my humble opinion, that is what the construction we can give to the definition of proof in the Evidence Act. Now, I have spoken about application of the doctrine of beyond a reasonable doubt in the matter of circumstantial evidence so far as primary facts and the guilt is concerned, and where exactly the doctrine has to be applied, and also regarding the two aspects of the definition, that is the use of the words either or. I think we have already gone for about, it is already about 1 hour, I suppose. Is it so? I can't hear you, Sukriti.
Yes, it's 1 hour crossed, but if you wish, you may continue.
No, we will. I think I have covered all the aspects of the definition.
Okay. So first of all, thank you so much for all the insightful details and all the experiences you have shared. So we have a couple of questions, out of which I'll pick two or three since we are running short with the timing. So the question is, it's by Vishwas Singh. But sir, what is the status of a retracted confession, and such confessions stand disapproved or not proved?
We have not talked about retracted confession so far. A retracted confession depends on the retracted confession of a co-accused. Is it what he says? Retracted confession.
He is asking what is the status of the retracted confessions.
At this point of time, I cannot often say regarding the retracted confession aspect, because he has confessed, and then under Section 30 of the Evidence Act, the confession of a co-accused has to be in the same trial, and there is the Baskerville's decision, which says that it is actually a testimony of an accomplice. Even uncorroborated testimony of the accomplice can be acted upon. But once he retracts from his confession in the box, what happens is that there is no confession at all. So that is what I cannot often say.
Okay. Another question is, so when judgment is given on the basis of evidence which is proved, and then it's proved false afterwards, so what are the repercussions?
I'm not clear about it.
When judgment is given on basis of evidence which is proved false afterwards, what are the repercussions? Like when any evidence has been presented and then...
The question is, it is simple. See, evidence is adduced on the fact and issue. The evidence is relating to the fact and issue and relevant facts. Cumulatively, the court considers whether the fact in issue exists or not, believes it to exist or not, or considers whether its existence is so probable that the prudent man ought to act on the supposition that it exists. Once those aspects are proved, fact in issue is proved, the right liability or disability, which is stated in fact in issue, has to necessarily follow. If it is proved, if it is a criminal trial, if it is proved beyond a reasonable doubt, the guilt of the accused is established beyond a reasonable doubt, conviction would follow. And then sentencing would follow. Or if it is civil case, the decree would follow. So that is ultimately the case would be dismissed. If it is not proved, necessarily it will be thrown out, the accused will be acquitted. I am not clearly understood the scope of the question.
The next question is by Pooja. She is asking that, is it difficult for the courts to interpret and rely upon the definition of proved in a case of circumstantial evidence, and if there exists an inability to establish the element of motive in it?
See, motive is only a circumstance. It is not necessary to prove motive in a particular case to establish the guilt of the accused. Motive is what impels a man to act on to commit a crime. Even if many crimes are committed without motive, on the spur of the moment, he may have an intention, and then intention and motive are two different things. Motive is only a circumstance to posit an inference that this might have happened. That is only one aspect of the matter. That is all. Merely because a person has a motive, you cannot infer that he has committed the crime. Yeah. Other circumstances should fully establish the fact in issue. And it should posit an inference of the guilt of the accused and of no other. Not just motive. There will be so many circumstances, as I have said. For last seen theory, then maybe rest just stay. So many things could be there.
In the last one, student anonymous attendee, he didn't mention his name, he is asking that what advice you'll give to the students who are aspiring to become a criminal lawyer, how far they should have the knowledge of criminal laws, and what role will it help, and how it will help them to be either a good
criminal lawyer. A comprehensive knowledge of the Evidence Act is necessary, which is if you read the autobiography of Justice K.T. Thomas, you will find that Justice K.T. Thomas is one of our finest lawyers, trial lawyers in Kerala. He had acquired such depth of knowledge in the evidence law during practice. But evidence as such is a dry subject. It is not a very exciting subject. But I would say that anybody who is aspiring to be a good lawyer should have knowledge of procedural laws and evidence law. Of course, substantive law should be there. In the preparation of pleadings, it should be there. But if you are trying to become a criminal law, the knowledge of procedural law and the Evidence Act is as important as the substantive.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. With this, we come to the conclusion of today's lecture. I once again thank you on behalf of LiveLaw for taking out the time and to share your experiences with us. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.